Yes,
Yes,
sir,
you
we can
are.
hear you.
Yes, you are.
And tell me, what is the duration you have planned?
So we would like you to speak for 45 minutes if you can, and we would like to field some questions from our audience as well.
Okay, there will be some questions.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, first of all, let me thank all of you, the team. What is it, 11 or 11?
Team Elevate, sir.
Elevate. And I, of course, is it the same group? Of course, students would be different, but whom I met at Vileparle in one of the some years back.
Sir, this is a different team, sir. So that time, sir, you met team R Factor, which was the first team of FRC in India. And they started this other team, sir, which is a school team now. The whole idea of FRC is to start as many teams as possible. So this is a school team at the Dhirubhai Ambani International School. So some of the members from there are here as well. Shiv Kampani, for example. But this is a different set of students, sir.
Mission it stands for. So it's wonderful, wonderful to be amongst you. And are you this time your competition is where? Delhi, New Delhi.
So the competition, because there are so few teams in India, the competition continues to be in. We have to travel. Am I audible?
Yes, miss, we can hear you.
Yeah. So because there are so few teams in India, the competition continues to be, we have to travel either to the US or to Australia. And the whole idea of this is to form as many teams so that we can have a regional competition in India. If we get 30 teams, then we can have a competition in India. Until then, we will have to travel.
Hello.
Hello.
Can you hear me? I'm not able to hear you.
So we can hear you and Ms. Meenal. We can hear you all.
You are audible.
Some connection problem.
So you are audible.
Everything seems to be okay here.
So we can hear you. Raghav, you want to say that you can? I don't know whether my connection is bad.
No, Meenati, you are coming through very well as sir.
Meenal, we can hear you and sir both.
Yes, okay. Everyone is audible.
Hello.
Yes, sir, we can hear you.
Now, okay. So, let's carry on because this connection is bad. I had some difficulty in connecting also, but let's hope that it will work. So compliments to all of you at Dhirubhai Ambani International School, the team L8 participating in this first robotic competition. I was asking, where is this tournament this time? Is it in New Delhi?
No, sir. It is actually in the US because the number of teams are less. So we have in India, so we have to travel abroad. When we have more than 30 teams in India, we can have a competition locally. So the idea is still to get many more teams here.
And when you have to travel to US?
So it will be next year, sir. Sometime, I hope it is sometime in March. I hope things are worth. The travel opens. Let's see how it goes. Well,
wonderful. So, I think it's, as I said, last time when I was there, I was kind of amongst the students who were kind of designing this robo and kind of testing it out, and they were just ready to move to the place of the venue of the competition. I think, robotics has become an important part of the modern world. and I'll come to STEM in a moment, but just to say that there was a time when everything we used to do by our hand, and that determined the human capability. Then the human beings developed machines, and so machines were a big force multiplier, and so whatever was the human capability, the human beings were able to do much more work than what they could do without a machine, and that made a big difference. In fact, that was the beginning of the industrial era. Now, going forward, we are now talking about intelligent machines. And intelligent machines, they have a lot of sensors, they have a lot of feedback mechanism, they have some, I won't say thinking ability, but some elements where some kind of an algorithm is kind of embedded. And so it can look at the surroundings and take decisions the way intelligent human beings take. So robotics is a big advancement, and it's an integral part of the new knowledge era, where we do expect the so-called exponential technologies, artificial intelligence, machine learning, big data, and so on. And it's not enough that you have just the brain, because while brain is very important, but along with the brain, you have to be able to have some mobility, the ability to carry out some physical work. So hands and legs, the limbs are also important. And robotics exactly does that you kind of make a combination of a mechanism or machine along with an embedded electronics or embedded rules of the game or embedded intelligence. And so, for example, you must have heard that there have been some trials people have done where you can order your pizza and a drone will come and deliver it at your home. Unfortunately, there are restrictions in terms of the air safety, the airborne objects, and so it has not become very all prevalent. But had that been the case, then during the times of this pandemic that we are currently in, you could have seen the grocer and the Amazons and the like, or even the nearby restaurants, delivering things at your in your balcony or on your terrace using drones. And that would have been a great application of robotics. So all I'm trying to say is, just like many modern technology gadgets, for example, a mobile has changed our life, I think robots of different kinds, those who can move on the ground, those who can move in air, those who can move in water, can do a variety of functions, and certainly would change our lives, whether we're talking about our personal or, for that matter, the professional life or the industrial activity in which many of us industrial or commercial activity in which many of us are engaged. So now let me come back to STEM for a moment, and then I'll come to this overall tournament. Now, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, in some manner of speaking, not exactly in the same way, because at school level, you don't talk so much of technology or engineering, but you do talk about science and mathematics. Now, what is science? I would define science as just our ability or our understanding of our surroundings, whether it is surrounding nature or whether it is surrounding other activities which are going on around us. We understand them exactly what is happening, and by way of our observation, by way of carrying out some experiments to prove that observation, and then based on that we several phenomena mankind has understood, which some of them do take place in nature. But once we have understood this basic scientific phenomena, then we can create several things in the laboratory environment, and going forward we can apply that. So application of scientific knowledge really becomes technology. So you learn science, you know surrounding nature, you understand what's happening around you, what phenomena are important, what is behind that. You can replicate that in laboratory. You can convert it into an application. And mind you, this application could be for our own benefit, but it could also be an application for taking science further. For example, we are talking about exploring moon, which is an important science mission. Now, one aspect of exploring moon is to actually land there. Either physically a human being can land there, as it had happened long time back, or you can send a vehicle, and that vehicle can land there and carry out experiments on the moon surface. Or for that matter, you want to explore very fundamental things, fundamentals of matter, fundamentals of energy. And you must have heard some major scientific experiments like the one which exists at CERN, Center for European Nuclear Research at Geneva. And there is a large Hadron Collider, which is actually a great experiment, which has been built at the cost of a couple of billions of dollars. And the purpose was to understand some very fundamental aspects of matter, fundamental aspects of energy, fundamental aspects of what was the situation when the universe began at the time of Big Bang, and so on and so forth. But this would not have been possible without access to technology. And that technology has come about because people have done science, understood science, applied that science, build instruments, build detectors, build methods to analyze what we are observing out of that detector. And that's how one could discover the so-called the Higgs boson, or God particle, as it is popularly called. Now, going forward, science application is technology. But then use of science and technology for design and building of machines, or for that matter, design and building of structures, is actually engineering. Now, robotics, that's what is the prime subject with us today. You use science, you use technology, you use detectors, you use many of the kinematic linkages and so on, but you build an intelligent machine. And so building a machine or building a structure, it belongs to this discipline of engineering. And you want to be able to do that, it's not enough that you just understand science, because you must understand science. You must understand the phenomena that take place. You must be able to translate that into algorithms on the basis of which you can calculate whatever you want to design, for example. And you want to do all this, and particularly when you want to do that in the context of the modern way of doing things, then mathematics becomes very important. Even to understand biological sciences, for example, you can't do without mathematics. So mathematics, many people are described as mother of all sciences. So that is where there is this important, singular importance of science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. Now, technology and engineering earlier were traditionally the subjects in the college domain after you have passed out of the schools. But for several years, the thinking has been that this is so fundamental going forward in terms of preparing our children to be capable youth and capable citizens of this world. It's very important that we must introduce these subjects right at the school level. And so many places in the school curriculum, or at least higher school curriculum, you give a lot of importance to the STEM, science, engineering, technology, and mathematics. And of course, those who go forward, for example, I did my engineering. Many of you may be wanting to do engineering. STEM is, of course, an integral part of your further learning and, of course, further career options. But for others who do not go to engineering or technology, even for them, I think STEM is very important, because I, just to tell you, I, at the, in one of the great universities, I saw students and the faculty, a big team, something like 25-30 faculty and maybe 50-100 students together. They were looking at you know, how a brain works, and actually look at very specific person specific solutions to looking at brain disorders and rectifying them. And that team included large number of computer scientists. That team included large number of electronics people. Of course, it included a lot of physicists and biologists and biochemists. But they could not have done this without the background in technology, engineering, and mathematics. So the point I'm trying to make is STEM is very important. And now, how do you bring this at the school level? And of course, all of you must have gone through your building. You know, robotics has become very, very common, very fashionable for school and college children. And there are competitions which take place all over. What I found was that as a part of this competition, the first group, you are actually building somewhat bigger robots. I think something like 50 kilo or 125 pound, as I heard at that time. And then you, of course, have a challenge where you use the standard elements to build a robot, but then you build it in a manner that it can deliver on those challenge which is before you. And then, of course, you go through trying it out, testing it out, and then be ready for participating in the competition. Now, from a learning perspective, I think this is excellent in the sense, you know, one aspect of learning is learning by doing, and or, you know, situated learning or hands-on learning. And you participate in such robotic competitions and go through this learning, you are, of course, practicing it on the robo, building a robo, training it, all that thing. But you are actually going through an experience of looking at a problem, building a device to solve that problem. I remember last time when I'd come there, this was a competition for cleaning up some water bodies or something. And then it was a floating robo which was creating, you know, lifting balls from a pool and taking it away, as if, you know, that becomes a simulation of how you clean the Mithi River, for example. I don't know what the challenge you are addressing now, but I think this allows you to do this, get through this hands-on experience of looking at a problem and solving a problem, and that too solving a problem using the most modern technology tools. Not that when it comes to actually doing these challenges, you will have these kind of toys. Those will become much more complicated. But this is the first step, because it's important that you get into that mindset of looking at a problem and solving that problem. And so I'm very glad that as a part of preparation for this competition, while you are sort of taking part in this competition, you are also simultaneously getting exposed to a variety of things in the society, including many things which sort of help you build your personality, and makes you sort of competent to face the real world out there. So all in all, I'm very pleased. I must compliment all those who are involved in kind of engaging students, and of course all students who are actually taking part in these competitions. Participation is the most important thing. I'm sure you will come back with some prizes. And also spread this message so that there are larger number of teams. I was hoping that the next tournament would be in India, but as I just heard, probably there are not enough teams in India to support an international tournament. But I think it's these efforts like what you are doing would spread, create enthusiasm among other school students, and you will have a larger number of teams. And with that, you create a new movement among the school children to, number one, understand problems and prepare, or get some experience on how to solve that problem. In the process, understand a bit of technology. And of course, you do that on the basis of whatever you learn in your schools. But going forward, it prepares you to do larger things. In the sense, going forward, you can choose your career path and decide. Because I know there are people have built robots to do very precision eye surgery, for example, where the precision involved is of the order of a micron. Or there are robotic devices which carry out agriculture activities with great precision, including deciding when to water, how much to water, whether to do it with fertilizer, take into account what is going to be the weather pattern for next 1 week, and decide how much water to be drawn from the ground. And there are several such things which can be done already in the context of not quite robotics, but intelligent agriculture is already in, even in our country. I have seen some examples where the entire cultivation, irrigation, all other supporting crop activities, is all done through the intelligent activities. They are not moving robots, but intelligent systems all the same. The same thing is true in many. I gave you example of drones, which are, of course, all of you, I'm sure, many examples you are aware. So it's a great thing that you are going through, and I congratulate you once again for this important effort. Now, in the remaining 10 minutes or so, I want to share with you an experience, which is something similar to what you are doing, but in a real life situation, and I think you will find it very, very interesting. This is the story of Madras Atomic Power Station. You know, it is close to Mahabalipuram near Chennai. Now, there are two 200 megawatt nuclear power plants there, and they are heavy water reactors. Don't get into the details there, but this is an old story. Sometime in maybe 80s or early 90s, I don't remember the date. But it was at that time, there are some internals. You know, in the nuclear reactor, there are many internals which you fit in. But then later on, you have to construct them in a manner that they will work for the life. For example, you compare that, we take the analogy of our human systems. We have several internal organs, heart, for example, most common. Once you come to life, your heart is supposed to perform continuously all the way through without a failure. But then you do develop disorders, and then you have cardiac surgeons who carry out surgery. Of course, there are methods of treating it with medicines. Cardiologists do that of work. There are methods for understanding what is the problem with heart. So there are many diagnostic methods. But then if it surgery becomes necessary, you do that. And now surgery, you do open heart, but you also can do keyhole surgery for doing. Now there are similarly internals in a nuclear reactor. And of course, nuclear reactor is a big thing. This one could be something like 5-6 meter diameter, 5-6 meter long. And so internal components are also very long. It could be something like 4-4.5 meters long. I'm talking about a particular baffle, it's called. But it's a plate, something like 4.5-5 meters long, not very thick, just 3-4 millimeter thick. And it is bolted onto the inner surface of this reactor. And the idea is that this water, which is introduced and taken out, you do it in a manner that it is uniformly distributed inside the reactor. Now, I will not go into detail as to how we found out, but this baffle, one day it came to light that baffle had in fact broken, and something like a meter size piece has fallen apart. And obviously that gave a lot of, you know, it's like imagine the heart valve, part of that valve has fallen apart, what will happen? So, of course, heart valve is small, this was a big thing, but I think it's a good analogy. Now, when that happened, the question was, of course, the reactors were shut down. And it was appearing that it's very difficult and we may have to write off these reactors because you can't run them like this. Now, that's a lot of money and also a lot of loss of electricity production. And so some of us were tasked, actually, we're a large group, and we were tasked to set that right, find out what has happened, figure out what is the solution and implement that solution. Now, imagine those days, and technology was not as advanced. Robo was not a very common term at that time, although in fiction movies, we're hearing about robots. So, and then, of course, a running reactor, you can't allow it to be remaining shut down for too long a time. We didn't have infinite time. Reactor back and running within that reactor running within time, and so we said, okay, let us see what we can do ourselves. But we also said that let's find out what is available elsewhere. So in fact, me and my colleague, we went on a global travel to find out whether we can sort of get and buy gadgets to do this. And to tell you frankly, we found nothing except some gadgets for visualization. You could insert a camera because, you know, this whole thing was closed. The openings were very small. The biggest opening was just 10 centimeters. So whatever you introduce, and I'm talking about meter sizes, but you can introduce that only through a 10 centimeter opening. And then you are talking about reaching several meters away, and you can imagine how the flexibility will play a role. You know, you can't make these things very, very rigid. So from that perspective, and when we found that there is nothing available, we decided to make it ourselves. And as I told you, we are racing against time. So we sort of made a long device, you know, like a laparoscope, where you have several things, but then you can operate at the tip. Either you have a little camera or you have small devices where you can carry out little biopsy or can carry out some other operations, suturing, for example. So something similar, imagine a laparoscope which is around 7 centimeter diameter, but some 6-7 meters long with articulation in between. So we build that device and introduce that and carry out this operation, laparoscopic operation inside the reactor because well, first of all, there was no space. There was no access to go there. You couldn't go inside. But even if one could go inside, the radiation field there is so large that nothing would survive. Even the lights which you had fitted, you know, because you have to illuminate that area, the light, the glass would get brown. And so the light would go dim within half an hour or 45 minutes because of radiation. So we had to take it out again, put another one, and like that we went through. And you'll be happy to hear that we finished that and got that reactor up and running in 6 months' time. And that reactor is running even now. So that is the power of robotics, if you can do. And but that's the power of, you know, this is many times we are used to using the robot in the sense. We can get a quadcopter or any other drone by somebody, and we can develop applications on that. Quite the same way as we get mobile from somewhere and build an app on that. I want to encourage you to go one step beyond, because of course that is important. That also will solve many problems. But you should be able to build your own mechanism, your own intelligent mechanism, your own robotic device to carry out a job and solve a problem, because many problems are actually very specific to our conditions, quite the same as what we faced. And so as you go forward, your experience of you know, participating on this robotic competition, now I know you buy this, you know, you have these ready-made components and you assemble. That, of course, is one way. But you should be able to do many things by yourself. More de novo approach, you should be also able to adopt. And if you do that, I'm sure you will make India technologically very strong. Because, you know, any country, a country becomes strong because of its technological power. It's not the money. It's not, you know, if money was a thing, then country like Saudi Arabia or many other rich countries would have become superpowers. Or Russia would not have become superpower. But it is the technology, the countries which have mastered technologies, which are superior to other countries. Those are the countries which become superpower. So I think if India wants to master or fulfill a dream of becoming a superpower, you must excel in technology. And you want to excel in technology, I think what you are doing currently at school levels is a wonderful example of the further learning process. And imagine, let's say 70-80% of the schools adopt the kind of hands-on learning that you are going through for different applications. And going forward, they adopt these STEM technologies to different fields. Again, as I said, not necessarily that they have to do engineering or technology, any field, including fields which are quite away from even science, because you know it has impacted our lives in a variety of ways. And we must be able to cater to the needs of the whole population on the basis of such technologies. And I think India should be on top. And that is what is the meaning of this experience that you are going through as I see this. So congratulations once again, and wish you all success in your endeavors. Thank you very much.
So it was an amazing and inspirational talk. Thank you so much for this. And it was lovely to hear your story. I mean, you always inspire us at each of the times that I've had the privilege to meet you. This is always my takeaway. This is truly inspirational. And when you talk about the country becoming a superpower based on technology, I think that is a loud and clear message that should really go to every single child here, so that they know that, you know, they are on the right path, and they should pursue this for STEM or otherwise in any field that they choose. It's such an important lesson and a takeaway for each one of us. It resonates with our thinking. And it resonates with this program, which is FIRST, which is for inspiration and recognition of science and technology.
Yeah.
We are really grateful for your talk today. And I now open it for questions. Manan, will you please moderate the questions?
Yeah, sure. So they can be, the questions can be about anything, right? You have questions about his career, about the field, about STEM, whatever you want.
Yes. Go ahead.
Just unmute yourself and you can ask your question.
Are you retired or are you still working?
Well, technically, the term to use is superannuated. You know, in government service, after you reach a particular age, then you have to kind of colloquially, what you call, you have to retire. So nobody can force you. You are always free to do. So in that sense, I superannuated in 2009 at the age of 66. And but I'm still active as I was earlier. And to get a feel of what I do, you visit my website, anilkakurkar.in, and that will tell you the kind of activities I'm currently engaged in. And I'm quite, happy and enthused about what am I doing. So in that sense, I'm active, but superannuated, yes.
Any other questions? Guys, we really encourage you to ask questions, because you won't have such an opportunity very soon.
Hello?
Yeah. Go ahead.
I want to ask as to how did you realize that science and math is what you really wanted to do at a very young age and not any other field? Like, what was that one thing that just went through your head at the time?
Well, I was in school in 50s. And so the both the world was not as advanced as it is today, and I did my schooling in a village, so even the facilities were not as advanced as they are today, particularly in cities. But I think it's the teachers who really make you. And I somehow while studying in the school, I developed fascination primarily for mathematics, but also for science. And so by the time I finished school, I was not as lucky as you people, where you are actually participating in such robotic competition. Nothing of that kind in that time. But it was clear to me that I want to study science and mathematics further. When I came to Science College in Mumbai, you know, you're all driven by peer pressure, the fellow students, friends. And I found that good students want to do engineering. So that became a big pressure. And then, of course, there is a other story. I have written my biography. So you can take a look at that if you can get it in your hand at some stage. But I wanted to do a topic which will first of all interest me. So that was mathematics and science. Then I found that application of mathematics and science is really engineering, and that seems to be the popular choice of the best of the students. So I moved on to engineering. When I finished engineering, I found most of the people in the most paying jobs were essentially in industrial engineering and marketing, and I found they are all repetitive because there is not much technology in the country, new technology. And I decided to myself that these repetitive jobs are not going to enthuse me. So I found that if I get into BARC, then I will be able to do some new development, which will be an opportunity to do new thing every day. So that brought me to research and development. And because it was BARC, it brought me to nuclear science and technology. So that's the way the journey has been.
So as a follow-up, we have a question in the chat, and it's, have you ever considered changing your line of expertise? And what made you choose nuclear energy specifically within the expansive field of STEM?
Well, as I told you, I got in BARC to be able to do new things every day. In fact, one of the passion for me was that every day I should be able to do something new, which I had not done yesterday. And BRC was one place which enabled me to do that. Then going forward, we had a training program, 1 year training. And we used to get really big luminaries, including Dr. Bhava at that time, to engage with us, talk to us. And they were actually designing the nuclear power program, and they told us how important it is. And if we don't do these things ourselves, the advanced countries are not going to allow us to get into this technology area because they will keep it to themselves. And so that is where we decided that, or I decided that, well, that's very interesting, and we must kind of take up this challenge. And being an engineer, I took on this challenge of nuclear energy and then worked on reactors and the like.
Right. Sanjay, do you have a question? Your hand is raised.
Yeah. Hello, sir. Sanjay here. Firstly, you're truly inspiring, and thank you so much for giving us this talk. Secondly, I had a simple question. What do you think the future of nanotechnology is?
You have to repeat the question, some interruption in between.
I wanted to ask you, what do you think the future of nanotechnology is?
Well, nanotechnology has become one of the most important things in contemporary times. Now, remember, it's not as if nanotechnology didn't exist earlier. For example, to tell you very simplistic way, even that kajal that we make is actually nanotechnology. Or, you know, the traditional medicine where you sort of, you know, some of these heavy metal things and you make a paste out of it by grinding on stone. And that has a miraculous effect for those who have experienced this. Allopathy will never allow that. Because they will consider heavy metals to be toxic and hazardous. But in small quantities and in that form, nano sizes, they have many properties which have wonderful, and this is now proven. So the point I'm making is, it's not as if nanotechnology didn't exist earlier. The name nanotechnology came about now, but mankind knew the importance of many new properties that get manifested at nanoscale. Now, today we know that at nanoscale there are a lot of things. It can happen in the area of chemistry, and several chemical features can be evolved. It can happen on the physical space, and you can get many transducers or many other effects because of nano sizes. You can also create nano objects like machines. For example, people who have made elements or gears which are micro sizes, but then for it to perform well, the tolerances and finishes have to be done at nano scale. And people have made that, and that also is, you know, for example, you can have a small capsule, which is actually a robo, and you swallow it. It can go through your digestive tract and come out of anus after a certain time, but carry out an entire visualization of this entire system. And when it comes out, it can play back the whole video to you. So all I'm saying is nanotechnology is a whole range of applications in a variety of areas. And so it's a huge, big field for almost any discipline. And so it's very important.
Thank you for your response. Now, Ryan Panamia, your hand is raised. Would you like to ask a question?
Yeah, hi. I had one question. Having worked in the field of nuclear energy for many years, what is your opinion on the weaponization of nuclear energy?
Well, we should, it's not, you know, nuclear energy is a very intense energy. A given material, chemical material, for example, explosive, can cause certain level of damage. Nuclear material in the purest form at the same quantity would cause, you know, would release energy which will be million fold or several million fold or several tens of million fold energy it would be released. And so the destructive potential of nuclear energy is very large. Now, before I go further, let me clarify that nuclear reactor, which produces electricity, and a nuclear weapon, they are two completely different things. A nuclear reactor can never explode and can never be used like a nuclear weapon. And nuclear weapon, you cannot produce electricity in a controlled way. So there are two different things. But let's come back to your question. And now the question is, India has been always pursuing this philosophy of world free of nuclear weapons. you know, we have been championing total nuclear disarmament, non-discriminative disarmament. And that was India's kind of advocacy and philosophy when we didn't have the nuclear weapons. But even after our acquisition of nuclear weapons, that continues our basic philosophy and policy. But at the same time, we have to recognize that we are living in a real life world. And India is one of the unique countries which shares boundary with two adversaries which have nuclear weapons. Now, if you want to carry on with your development, if you want to carry on with meeting aspirations of Indian people under an environment where you are threatened by two nuclear adversaries all the time, clearly such development will not be possible. Nothing. You will have to keep compromising on things after things. And so it became absolutely essential for India to acquire nuclear weapons. And many people have described Indian weapons as weapons of peace. So I'm not a champion of nuclear weapons in general, but I think in the current scenario, India possessing nuclear weapons is an extremely important thing to make sure that we can carry on with our peaceful development.
Thank you. And now Anavi has a question.
Hello, sir. I had a question.
Hello.
What are one of the main things that is holding India back from becoming a superpower in the field of technology? Is it rather our restrictive curriculum that more focuses on memorizing textbooks instead of hands-on learning? Or is it our low literacy rate and the lack of accessibility?
I'm glad you raised this question, and I would take a little longer to address that issue. This is a very important question, and it's a deep-seated question. And I will begin with our cultural mindset. I will, for example, some time back, in the United States, a survey was conducted of the United States, the immigrants to United States from other countries have contributed a lot to technological development in United States, particularly, the startup culture. Many big startups, the billion-dollar startups, as they called it in that report, have been created by immigrants. And just like there is an issue for student visa now, some years back there was a issue for visa in general. And at that time, one of the think tanks in US carried out a study to figure out the contribution made by immigrants to billion-dollar startups in United States. And when they looked at which are the countries from where maximum number of billion, people who have created billion-dollar startups have come, which country was on top? It was India which was on top. Indians who immigrated to US have made maximum number of billion-dollar startups in the United States. Now recognize that these students have studied like you or many others in Indian schools or Indian colleges. And only then they went to United States. Now, if a small number of people who have gone there, they can actually lead the table of people who have created billion-dollar startups in United States. The question is, there is a much larger number of young people who remained behind, or even now they remain behind. So technically, India should have maybe 10 times or 100 times more such billion-dollar startups in the country. But that we don't see happening. So the point is, I'll come to the education separately. That of course, certainly something needs to be done. But there is something more to that. To describe it in a very simplistic way, I'll carry it to say it's the ecosystem. Ecosystem for, you know, as I told you, robotics, you are getting into challenges. A challenge does not recognize whether you are a scientist or you are an economist or you are a social scientist or you are a mechanical engineer or what is that. It is the other way. You have to look at the challenge and find out what are all these specializations, what are all the expertises, what are all the disciplines that you must bring to bear on solving that challenge, addressing that challenge, solving that problem. And so different people working together, for example, your team, you can't make a one-person team. You have to have a team of a sizable number of students. So similarly, you want to create a startup, it has to be a very important group activity. And that group activity many times spreads across institutions. There may be a lab, there may be a financial institution, there may be some government institution, there may be some licensing environment, and so on and so forth. And only when all of them work harmoniously can many such things happen. We Indians, I'm sorry to say that, and I think you children should make sure that you are not like that. But there is a strong silomity mentality in the Indian mind. Of course, it's changing. If you look at the history of last several decades, which I have seen, it's certainly changing. But it is still very much there. And then, so it is my department, that is your department. In a university, they will say, no, I'm a physics fellow, you are a chemistry fellow. If I'm doing BSc in chemistry and principal, and then I want to suddenly change over, or from MSc, I want to change over to PhD, change the discipline. In India, it is very difficult. Abroad, it is so easy. So there are obstacles across these silos. We have created these obstacles, and that makes it very difficult to make that. And it is changing slowly. Government is also giving a lot of thrust to make that change happen. But it's a slow process. And that's one big reason why we are behind. Secondly, of course, our education also, the way we learn and way we teach is also a major issue. For example, many people have described our education as a kind of assembly line in an industry. You know, just like in industry, you have an assembly line and then you get one component and somebody puts another component, somebody puts third component, and the object keeps moving up and becomes the finished products at the end. Same thing, you get admitted in the first class and the teacher will pump in you whatever is there in your curriculum, whether you understand or not, whether you like it or not. All your need is that you must get marks in the exam. That's what decides whether you are good or bad. Now, if there is somebody who is very interested in one subject and maybe he wants to go deep in that and at the same time not interested in something else, the person will not be able to move forward because he would fail in that subject. And unless he clears that subject, he won't be able to go to the next class. Now, these are, you know, so it's important that we need to have student-centric learning, student-centric education. There must be choices for students. And there is that education which is called constructivist education. We have talked a lot. There are lots of books around. But in reality, our education is like an assembly line. And that is, again, there is a lot that needs to be changing. And finally, of course, there is very little connection, you know, between industry, the education, the society. And so we don't get into hands-on learning or situated learning. And that is, and there are, I can go on, there are many. But I think let's look at the brighter side of it. The brighter side of it is things are changing. For example, we have IITs. IITs, of course, many people complain that they are not in the top 100 or 200 of the best universities in the world. But recognize IITs are not as large as universities. They are essentially like, specialized thing. You compare, compare IIT Bombay in electrical engineering, for example, or some such topic, or any other IIT, and compare their global ranking, you'll find their global ranking is in 20s or 30s or 50s. So we have great institutions. We need to have more such institutions. India is a very big country, and rather, a few great institutions and then everybody wanting to rush, the mad rush that we have for JEE, which actually is again a big distortion. I don't know how many of you know, but the coaching classes, I'm sure many of you might be going. The coaching class economy is as big as the education budget of the country. And it's actually leading to children getting burnt out. I would want to create a system where you can leverage that investment into a better education system where you can create billion-dollar entrepreneurs. And I'm sure this can be done, and people who run coaching classes, they can invest in new things and do good contribution to education. Such things are possible, but I leave that for another day. But I think this is what you have asked is a very deep question, and there is a long answer, but I hope you have got a flavor of the problem we are in.
Yes,
but recognize that we are better. We are much better than what we were maybe 10 years back.
Now it's already past 5, so we'll be taking just 2 more questions. Lavanya, you have your hand raised. Would you like to ask a question?
Yeah, thanks. Hello, sir. It was an honor hearing you speak. I have a question for you based on energy. Do you believe that nuclear energy will become a more dominant resource in the future, or do you think we'll develop a commercially viable renewable source of energy before that?
Well, the answer is both, because renewable energy there is no CO2 emission, and that's the kind of energy we need, because we have this threat of climate change looming large. Now, just to tell you some time scale, recognize that, if you go by the reports of IPCC, Intergovernmental Plan Panel for Climate Change, and such other bodies, they have said that you want to make sure that climate change does not affect us very badly. It's already affecting us, but does not affect us very badly. Then we must restrict the global warming to within 1.5 degrees Celsius of the temperature that it was during pre-industrial era. Now, to be able to reach that situation, experts have done calculations which say that within 10 years from now, that is by the year 2030, we should reduce the CO2 emission to below 45% of what the emission was in the year 2010, not today, 10 years back. Whatever was the emission at that time, you must reduce to 45% of that. And that you should do by 2030, 10 years from now. But that's not enough. And then on it says that by 2050, which is 30 years from now, you must actually eliminate CO2 emission completely. And if you do that, then only you will be able to restrict the global warming to 1.5 degrees above the pre-industrial era condition. Now the challenge is, how do we do that? Now it's one effect is saying that, well, don't use energy. Now there are rich countries in the world And for them, they use energy more than what is optimum or more than what is necessary to reach the best quality of life or what is known as Human Development Index. So if these countries, even if they cut down their energy consumption by half or one third, or in some countries, even one fourth, nothing will happen to the quality of their life. And these are the countries which have kind of cornered all the resources. And these are the countries which are kind of also occupied the carbon space, in the sense they are the major emitters of CO2, at least as far as per capita energy emission is concerned. Now, what about the larger part of the world, 80% of the population, global population? It is still developing. It still has to reach the best Human Development Index. And that cannot happen unless it gets access to more energy. And if this larger population of the world, if you want kind of take them to the same level of Human Development Index, you need to create access to much larger energy. Now, you cannot live with this disparity, because if you live with this disparity, that itself is the cause for conflict or the disturbed world, which will never be peaceful. So what is the solution? The solution is we must get more energy to meet this requirement of larger number of people for they to also reach the same high Human Development Index. And we should do that in a manner which does not add carbon dioxide to the atmosphere. And that can be done very easily. I'm getting echo from somewhere.
So it should be correct.
So that can be done by resorting to renewable energy, as you correctly observed, solar or wind. Biomass is also there, but biomass quantity-wise is not very large compared to total needs, although it is important in terms of current needs. But the problem is solar and wind both are variable energies. And you can't run a large grid, or you can't run a factory, or in fact, even in household, you don't want the variable voltage light becoming dim and bright, and or the if you have such variable voltage, your fridge or the computer, they will all conk off. So it's important that as far as grid is concerned, that grid is very stable. Now, for grid to be stabilized, you must have a certain minimum fraction of what is known as baseload energy. In the sense that, because then the rest of it, grid can manage by grid controls. Now, what are the baseload sources which can run 24/7 and generate energy, but at the same time not emit carbon dioxide? Nuclear energy is the only such source. Of course, one can argue that no, battery I will have, and with battery I can show that we can produce economic electricity which can be 24/7. But if you do the economics in great detail, you would find that there are many hidden elements in that, both in terms of the costing. I don't want to go into detail, but also in terms of the cost that the project proposer or the project developer incurs, and the cost which the public or the government would have to incur later. So if you do that on a level playing field, you would find that you are talking about baseload energy. You have actually no option but to resort to nuclear energy. Now, Germany has recognized this, because they are now feeling they have made good advancements in renewable energy, which is a good thing, but they are seeing the economic implications of this. They will, of course, find solutions to do with this. Japan, which actually is the sensitivity of nuclear is because there was Hiroshima, Nagasaki, which happened in Japan. And also resistance to nuclear power is there because there was accidents like Fukushima, which also happened in Japan. But Japan is totally dependent on energy from outside. There is very little energy on which Japan can get on its soil. And they have looked at their energy security in the long run, and their government and also the parliament has actually cleared or passed a policy which says that nuclear would remain a part of their energy mix. At least 20% power in Japan will be derived from nuclear energy. So the short point I'm making is, today when the renewable energy proportion is small, it's good that we have the thrust. But I can't see the world going like this and saying that we'll get into zero carbon completely on the basis of renewable energy. That, to my mind, is not tenable. And so nuclear energy will have to come in.
We have a question from Nilesh.
Yeah, greening, sir. This is Nilesh here. You know, it was indeed a privilege meeting you a couple of years ago at the Parle factory.
Nice meeting you again.
Yeah. So, sir, one thing that you really, really pinpointed was, you know, how India has a potential, but unfortunately, you know, for some reason, we have not been able to really garner this, you know. One of the key reasons, as you rightly said, is that we have an assembly line of, you know, education system rather than the hands-on learning. Though a few privileged teams, like, you know, we have a couple of teams who are able to do hands-on learning, robotics, STEM, how can we make a system, or how can we make an ecosystem wherein this is made accessible to a lot more schools, you know, who unfortunately don't have the privilege as of now? And also, how corporates can really help us, you know, in taking these initiatives to a much larger scale of people, much larger mass of school children?
Thank you. That's again another important issue, very important issue.
Yeah.
Please allow me to give a somewhat longish answer.
Yeah.
Now, recognize that if you look at Indian population as a whole, larger part of Indian population actually lives in villages, not in cities. The 2011 census shows actually 2/3 of Indian population was in villages. Today, it might have come down because migration continuously takes place. But I still think larger part of population is in villages. The second thing is, we have done, according to me, a very wrong thing in terms of ignoring villages, in spite of the fact that father of our nation had actually emphasized on the great focus that we need to place on villages. We somehow have a notion that village means agriculture or related activity, and also have a notion that agriculture can never give you adequate rewards. And so migration is something inevitable, and cities will keep growing. Now, while cities will keep growing, migration is inevitable. In India, migration is taking place perhaps at the fastest pace compared to other countries. Now, we don't have to seek that distinction. Particularly in today's area, knowledge era, if we can talk about work from home, what prevents a youth or a student or a child in a village to work from village and fulfill the needs of the village, fulfill the needs of the city, and fulfill the needs of the rest of the world, very much the same way as people working in IT industry do today, working from home. Now, if our education system is, and if we have empowered our youth rightly, and in the knowledge era and the technologies that are around, this is eminently possible. We don't seem to be even paying one bit of attention to this. And this is the problem. We talk about demographic dividend, but the larger part of demographic dividend is sitting in villages. And if you don't do capacity building of these people, then instead of being a dividend, they will become a drag. The same thing is true about poor people in cities, for example. They can't get admission into elite schools like yours. Now, this is what I think we need to change. Now, superimpose on that the silo mentality. It's not that silo mentality sits only in cities or only in industry. It's there all across, even in villages and all. We have that, you know, where we suffer the common varnashram, same problem. Now, imagine that we think of an ecosystem, you know. How does innovation flourish? Innovation flourishes by way of an ecosystem where people from diverse and complementary capabilities can work together across the institution boundaries. That's what we talked about earlier. Now, you want villages to also come up and contribute. And according to me, villages can contribute much more than cities, because in villages, youth can contribute, of course, to agriculture sector, but they can also contribute to industry or manufacturing sector, as well as to services sector, leveraging the modern technologies, the disruptive technologies. In cities, also in principle, you can contribute to all the three, but I think there is some echo. But in cities, the opportunity for contributing to agriculture are rather limited because there is no land. You can do some hydroponics or other such things, but limited. So in principle, the opportunity for young people who are properly educated, properly trained, are competent in technology, the opportunities are higher in villages than in cities. Unfortunately, that If when I tell you like this, you will say I am living in a utopian world. But that is the reality, and that is the failure of our education system. So I actually champion a concept called silage, essentially to build a right ecosystem in village. Silage is actually a combining city and village together, I think one word. So it's a kind of a knowledge bridge between city and village to realize an ecosystem in villages where you not only make a difference to the village economy, but also to the economy of cities and the world at large. And that is what we should aim at in doing, anything with education, anything with villages, anything with ecosystem. And whatever corporates can do for this would be wonderful. There are many dimensions to this. This is not a single focus item, but whatever you can do would be great.
So, in fact, just to add to this, we are actually collaborating with the Atal Tinkering Labs and trying to take this to all the, you know, all the schools across India, and they have some 5,000 schools. So we had met Mr. Ramanan from the Niti Aayog and Mr. Amitabh Kant, and he had the same ideas that you said, you know, that we have to go to the interiors of India and take this program there. So, in fact, I was even speaking with Pallavi, and we were looking at doing something there and, you know, collaborating with you and seeing how we can move ahead. I think there are just two last questions. So, would you have time?
Yes.
Okay. Manan, you want to take those two questions?
Yuvraj Garg, you had a question?
Yeah, so I just wanted to ask that which organization looks after the safety issues like regarding the nuclear powers in India?
Yes, there is a regulator by name Atomic Energy Regulatory Board. Now, this regulator is completely independent of Department of Atomic Energy. It has a chairman. And then I think three or four other members. But I know at least two of them are drawn from outside. You know, you run the regulator, you also need domain knowledge. So there are some people who are experienced in atomic energy, but there are also some people who are experienced in chemical industry, who are experienced in radiation safety, who are experienced in biosciences. So there are such people, experts from outside, and together they comprise this Atomic Energy Regulatory Board, and they regulate all activities related to anything that emits radiation, both for energy generation, but also for example, if you go to a nuclear medicine center, or you take a CAT scan, or for that matter, an ordinary X-ray, even there you will find people, they have to be first cleared by Atomic Energy Regulatory Board, and they have to wear those radiation dosimeters. So they are all under the supervision of Atomic Energy Regulatory Board. So that is the regulator.
Okay, thank you, sir.
One last question. Could Raghav, could you ask your question?
Yes. Thank you, sir, for talking to us today. I just wanted, this is more of a personal experience question, because, you know, apart from all the, you know, information you've given us today, how was your experience working on the submarines, you know, fitting them up with nuclear capabilities, you know, considering that submarines are, you know, one of the, if not the most important part of the Indian Navy? So just a personal experience question. I just wanted to, like, you know, kind of understand how that, you know, was for you.
Well, within the limits of what I can tell you, submarine reactor is far, far compact, far more compact compared to the normal reactors that we are used to. Because, you know, there is a severe space limitation, there is a severe weight limitation, and because power or the submarine is a platform, and it more potent platform you have to make, it must have much higher power with much lesser weight and space. And so that's a major engineering challenge. Imagine, you know, some of these tools, robotic devices that you make. Imagine I ask you that whatever you are doing, you do that in 1/10 that space or 1/5 that space. And do you imagine the challenges that you would have, both in terms of the architecture as well as in terms of technology, because the current technology you would find will not do, because if you have very small components, but at the same time you are there to withstand much larger forces or much more harsh conditions, you need very special materials. So that is the kind of challenge in a submarine technology.
Right. So you've talked to us about engineering, about STEM, about nuclear physics, your own career, and, you know, you've brought up concepts such as SILIT. So I think that pretty much wraps it for today's session. And it was genuinely an honor to have had the opportunity to interact with you. And on behalf of Team Elevate, I would like to thank our chief guest, Dr. Anil Karodkar, who graced us with his thought-provoking address. And it sets a perfect platform for our endeavors later on through this field. So thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
It's been totally
inspirational. To all of you. Hello?
Sorry. Yes, sir. This has been totally inspirational. Thank you so much for your time today.
Thank you. Thank you. All the best.
Bye.
Bye.